In a few days, I'll be visiting the Woodcraft store in Dallas, Texas. I've been meaning to do some projects that combine metal and wood, and I thought this trip would be a perfect opportunity. I chose to do a set of marking knives, and I'll handle the metal work here at my shop, and then get some help with the wood scales down in Dallas.
So Howard, I came down here, and I've got a couple of marking knives that I made, and I was hoping you could help me scale one side.
Oh gosh, you bet.
Okay, because we're going to use the backside as a registration point, right?
Okay.
So I want to put a nice scale on the front.
We can do that. You know, we offer at Woodcraft, we have all different types of wooden blanks. We have everything from book matched stabilized, which are very durable.
That's this stuff here?
That's that stuff. If you were going to use it outdoors, if it was going to be in a hunting situation where it was wet all the time,
yeah,
that won't warp like normal wood.
What does that mean, stabilized?
Stabilized, it's been baked in an oven or a microwave.
Really?
And was saturated with basically a super glue, which makes it virtually bomb-proof.
Really?
Which, of course, then makes it waterproof because it's plastic.
And this is dyed?
Yeah, that's dyed, right. So the dye is actually all the way through it. If you cut, if you sand, no matter what you do, it's that color green all the way through.
Oh, that's super cool.
It's cool stuff, yes. And then, of course, we have normal knife blanks. You can buy solid chunks and saw them up however you want. We do have some that are already sawed into the two sides for you. Just depends on what you want to do.
Oh, I like that.
Isn't that pretty? Pretty stuff. Anything that interests you, or you want to do something fun and be local?
I think I like that idea.
Yeah,
what
that
is this?
That is Texas ebony.
Texas ebony?
It's quite rare. It only grows at the border between Texas and Mexico. Once you get inland Texas, those trees stop. It's just at the Mexican-U.S. border.
It feels super dense,
It's dense. It compares very similarly to Cocobolo or Bacote.
Yeah. Okay.
Basically, it's hard as a rock. It's naturally oily. That also would do good outdoors. That can get wet because the oil in the wood doesn't care.
Yeah, I like the idea. Plus, I'm in Texas.
You're in Texas. You got to make it.
I can't get this back home.
No, you cannot.
Not easily.
You can't. And actually, we get it from a person that goes to the border between Texas and Mexico, picks it up.
Yeah,
the trees aren't really trees, they're more like a bush.
Okay.
So there's usually not a lot of hardwood, and this particular piece is fun because it's got some sap going through it that we can either have show or not show.
That's up to you.
Yeah, I mean, that's part of the character of Texas ebony.
So where should we start with this kind of project?
Basically, we need to either decide, do we want to cut each piece out of this separately, or we take it to the bandsaw and rip it down the middle, open it up like a book, and then the two sides would be what we call book matched.
Yeah.
And we could book match it with the sapwood here or here. That's just design. That's up to you.
Okay.
That's typically what happens. This blank started out solid, was run through the bandsaw and split open. And so on this, the book matching with the sapwood could either be far away from one another or side by side. Just depends on how you want to do it, based on how it looks.
Sure.
Once we get it down to that manageable size, then we'll scribe the design, go to the bandsaw, cut that shape out closely. We don't want to cut into the metal. We don't want to ruin your nice metalworking.
Right.
Then come in and either sand or you could use a router. Lots of ways to get that exactly the size we want it.
Okay.
So first step would be off to the bandsaw.
And what kind of thickness do you think we should shoot for? What is this, about 3/8?
Probably about 3/8. If we split this right down the middle, we should be plenty.
Right.
If you want thicker sides, then we'll cut it in half. We'll make one side out of this and one side out of that. And then they wouldn't be book matched.
I think we should be able to book match.
Oh, yeah.
3/8 looks like it'd be fine.
Yeah, by the time you get this thickness, we trim it up. I'm sure you're going to want some nice, cool shape to it. And maybe a thumb notch or something.
I like that idea.
Yeah. This will get a little thinner by the time we clean it up. But these two plus that thickness, you're still going to have a decent hefty knife in your hand.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah. So off to the bandsaw we go. cut on a bandsaw, sometimes it's hard to get close to the line. Mm-hmm. And when in doubt, always give yourself plenty of room. There's a technique called rake and relief.
Ah.
Now, you know about relief. You go in and you make a lot of cuts, and then when you sweep all that out of there, that junk falls away.
Right.
And you can turn a tighter curve than the blade wants you to.
Right, right.
All right. Then there's a technique called raking, where it lets you trim as close to the line as you want. The bandsaw, the teeth have set. You know, every other tooth goes one way, every other tooth goes the other way. If I come in sideways on the tooth, it's going to act like a rasp. We'll power up here, we'll rake this off. Now, if you push forward, you'll end up cutting too far and you'll cut into your line and ruin your piece.
Sure.
If you rake, you pull toward you.
Oh, look at that, that's awesome.
Isn't that cool? It will kiss it right to the line.
Look at that.
You can rake either direction. The hardest temptation is you want to push forward. As soon as you do, you'll overcut.
Sure.
Now you can control how aggressive the raking is. If you come in right parallel with the blade, you'll get a real soft rake. If I come in at an angle, it's more aggressive.
Oh yeah, look at that, wow.
And I mean, it'll take it off pretty quick.
Holy smokes, yeah.
I can soften that down by coming in more parallel and not take too much off. You want to try to balance both sides of raking. If, so to speak, you did a whole bunch of raking going clockwise, you wear out all the teeth on the left-hand side.
Right, right, right.
Then that blade won't cut straight. It will not cut going right, but it'll cut on the left-hand side because
right.
You've worn those teeth down. So ideally, you do some of your raking on the left side, some of your raking on the right side, because then it wears your blade evenly and the blade will still cut straight. You don't ruin a blade.
Nice.
Those look both pretty close.
Yeah.
Let's go to the spindle sander and clean these up.
All right, cool.
In the store, a lot of our knife makers will just glue their sides on, leave them plain, or you always have the option of pinning them, or you even buy little screws. I personally like to pin them. I think they look good.
Yeah.
Doesn't add any strength. It's just design.
Yeah.
You can get the pins in either brass or aluminum, so gold or silver. What do you like to do? You want to pin them or leave them natural?
No, I think we'll pin them.
Yeah.
I had already drilled the blanks with 3/16.
Okay, perfect.
So, like you said, these will just be decorative, yeah. And we'll run these through. And
just a simple hacksaw, we'll cut these to length.
Yep.
Very good.
Yep.
You know how to use a hacksaw, don't you?
I'll figure it out. I watched somebody do it.
All right.
Just going to use some sandpaper to help hold this in
place. That's right. Our vise isn't quite close enough to hold that, so sandpaper will give it a little bite. Oh, okay, that's how you measure it. Use it to get the right length, plus a little.
Yeah, just leave it a little fat, right?
The brass or the aluminum will sand real easy. And I can even be a good hand-me-hold-me person. I'll catch that little dew when it comes off. If it goes to the floor, we'll lose it.
Now we just need to drill through that ebony.
We've got the drill press set up. We're good to go.
Yes, sir. I've got a metal polisher back at the shop.
You bet.
But I've never used it on wood.
This is called the Beall buffing system.
Beall buffing.
It's B-E-A-L-L.
Okay.
It's really slick. It combines three different buffing wheels of different fabric. And each buffing wheel is labeled Tripoli, White Diamond, and Carnauba.
Oh.
Carnauba will be our finest polish. Carnauba is hard as a rock.
Yeah.
You'll only have to do this one time. It will literally last forever.
Nice.
Carnauba doesn't wear off. It's not finger oil, water, acetone, alcohol. Nothing bothers it.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So this will literally stay polished forever.
Okay.
Only way you can get this off is either acetone it or naphtha, mineral spirits, and scrub it off.
Ah, okay. Right?
The beauty of it is it's not finished. So if halfway through we discover we missed a spot at the sander, we stop, you resand it, and then you just buff again.
Go right back at it.
Because it's already dry.
Very nice.
It's slick. Now when you buff, it's just like with metal, you're going to stay below center line.
Okay.
This is Tripoli. Tripoli will easily remove 220 all the way down to 150 scratches.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So this will do whatever we need it to do. Going to stay below center line. Let's see what this Texas Ebony looks like. This should be spectacular.
Oh, look at that.
Now, that's not polished yet.
Yeah,
that's
but
just
you
step
can
one.
See it.
You can see it coming. And there we go.
That's beautiful.
We still got some scratches. Those will eventually go away by the time we're finished with it.
Okay.
Doesn't matter which way you go on it. It buffs. It doesn't care. Probably similar to metal. You can go in any direction. It's going to turn our metal black,
yep.
But that will come off because that's wax.
Yep. Yeah, well, that's looking nice. That's
so
looking
there's,
nice.
And that's not polished yet. That's just step one. So there's Tripoli.
Okay.
We come to this guy. White Diamond is a finer compound. It's designed to get rid of the scratches left by the Tripoli.
Okay.
Softer wheel. You can't cross-contaminate. If you were to accidentally put your Tripoli on this, it would ruin this wheel.
Sure.
You have to stay in the same wheel for the same compound. And there's White Diamond.
Woo, that's looking good. Here, let me catch up to you.
Yep, catch up to me, and then we'll switch over and put the Carnauba on there. Might charge it again. I was messing with it a little bit there.
Look at that.
Isn't that sweet?
They look beautiful.
Now let's polish them.
All right.
The Beall system is slick because these are not locked on.
Okay.
It's self-threading. You hold the head and it just unscrews. You just get this started just a little bit and it's self-tightening. So it locks on automatically. Which that's why you're able to get it back off because it hasn't locked on.
Right, right, right.
So it makes change out easier. All right, some Carnauba. Again, Carnauba is the hardest wax we have available to us.
It smells nice.
Yeah, it's got a great smell, and it's pretty bomb-proof. It's very durable. Oof. There's your shine.
Look at that.
Yeah. Go.
Lovely.
Look at the difference in the shine.
Yeah, look at that.
A little more depth, a little more beauty. And this is bomb proof, whereas the White Diamond isn't. That
right.
would rub off. This won't.
Yeah.
never used Carnoubi before.
It's wonderful on small projects. Arts and crafts, knives. A lot of bow and arrow guys, archery guys, will use it on their bow because it can handle the abuse.
What do you think?
These are gorgeous.
Oh, these look great. Look at that.
Isn't that fun?
These are awesome.
That's what's fun. You put them together and then they open up.
Yeah. These came out awesome.
Isn't this cool? Dude, this is great, man.
Thank you so much.
This is great. Come back anytime.
I sure will. I love this.